start out with this question at the beginning. The title of this message is Lifestyles. So I have this question for you, and I want a little bit of interaction, okay? You can speak through your masks. I might have to have an interpreter, but how would you describe your lifestyle? Okay? Give me some words to describe your lifestyle. Boring. All right, boring. Okay, I didn't think. What was that? Retired or tired? Retired. Someone else? By faith? Oh, sorry. I thought you were reading into my message. Fast paced, okay? Not as usual? Okay, good. I hope you'll just sit there. Now, there's another thought in this first paragraph. It is, how would those who know you really well describe your lifestyle? And anybody want to take a shot at that? You're just kind of maybe afraid. Demanding, controlling, compulsive. No, maybe that's not you. But hopefully they'd say things like maybe trustworthy, maybe a word like unassuming. What's that? Optimistic. Yeah. Oh, that'd be cool. So, you know, we have our lifestyles. And I was thinking about this as we come to this, our study of the book of Galatians. I remember my, when I began in ministry back in, after seminary and in 1972, my first study with the youth group that I worked with was from the book of Galatians. And I can still see myself sitting in the room there with these students around, and we had a great time going through this little book of Paul's. You know, when Paul wrote this letter to the people of Galatians, the people in like central Turkey, that's where they lived. It was a region. A region that Paul had actually taken, he'd done evangelism there, and he'd planted churches in that whole large area. We're not exactly sure how large it was, but at that time. But Galatia was made up of people from the from Europe. They were called the Gauls, and the Gauls had migrated from central Europe down into Galatia, well, what became Galatia, it is now Turkey. But Paul was really concerned about them, so much so that of all his letters, this is the only one that he doesn't give any attention to commending them, praising them for something that they did. And I was talking to someone recently about how do we talk to each other in a world that is so divided right now, in a country that's so divided. And one of our missionaries shared with me, he said, well, we've learned that maybe one of the ways to do this is to make some comments about what people have said or what they've written. Something like this. Let me paraphrase what you've been saying. That's a good way to start. And then probably to commend them, to praise them after you paraphrase what they've said, and commend them. I can see you've thought this through and you've got some interesting ideas. And then the last of the three P's was to probe and say, now, could we examine some of these thoughts together? A more civilized way than to write a tweet full of hatred and division and mean-spiritedness. But Paul doesn't do anything like that. He doesn't praise them. He just doesn't commend them. He just comes right out of the gate with some his serious concerns, and he maintains those concerns all the way to the end of this sixth chapter letter. He called their lifestyle, you ready for this? Foolish. Foolish. And that it was being, and that they, in other words, they were being, they were a bunch of, their lifestyle was they were weak, and they were so easily sidetracked, and they didn't have any spine or backbone in the midst of a lot of pressure. The book of Galatians is a book where the theme of the book of Galatians is spoken in chapter 3. It is that the just shall live by faith. Righteous people, people who have been made righteous by God, will live their lives by faith. And he says to them, you're being sidetracked, so easily sidetracked, and going back to you want to take something that is so insufficient, this lifestyle of the law, living under the law, living under the, not just the Ten Commandments, but all the ceremonial Jewish laws. That's what you're trying to do right now. You're living by the law. You're becoming legalists rather than live a life that is regulated by a law of faith. Galatians is a powerful book. It deals with a life of faith is a life that experiences freedom in Christ. It is called by many over a period of time, it's called the Magna Carta of spiritual liberty. You know, I remember standing looking at the Magna Carta in the Library of Congress. No, it wasn't the Library of Congress. It was the official documents. What's the word I'm looking for? Archives, yes, National Archives. And there it was, the Magna Carta. It described the rights of all free Englishmen. I suppose the word men stands out too much in that. But the Magna Carta was actually the format for our Declaration of Independence. And so this is called kind of the Christian's Declaration of Independence. It's been referred to as the battle cry of the Reformation. When did Martin Luther write his complaints against the church and hang them on the Wittenberg door? 1517, more than 500 years ago, the battle cry of the Reformation. And Martin Luther's life was radically changed as he sat down to write a commentary on the book of Galatians. And it just continued to set him free. Now, as you look at your notes today, I'm going to follow these. We're going to move right along. I'm just going to move, I hope. And you do too. There are 6 points right now. My wife said, how much time are you going to give to that, each one? Stick with me, please. Let's just, but I do suggest this. At the bottom of the page, I wouldn't want you to miss it. On the bottom of the right side, it says, it's this star. And it's all these verses are starred. And I say, to help in your grasp of this gospel, this really, really important gospel, I'd encourage you to, whatever translation you use, to memorize these verses and start to chew on them. I don't mean just memorize them so that we're not going to do a test. You're not going to stand up here in front and prove how righteous you are to everybody here. No, we're not going to do that. We're going to let's just chew on these truths together. So we begin this morning with Paul talking about a different gospel. Now, just 2 verses out of chapter 1, and we'll come back to this next week, but I want you to just take a look at chapter 1, verses 6 and 7, Paul writes this, "I am astonished that you are so quickly deserting the one who called you by the grace of Christ." You're deserting his message, and are turning to a different gospel, which really is no gospel at all. Evidently, some people are throwing you into confusion and are trying to pervert the gospel of Christ. You think he was cautious with his words? No, not at all. But he's really, really dead serious. He is really concerned right out of the gate. I can't believe it that you are turning to this other gospel, which is not really another gospel. It's not other good news. It's actually that which will enslave you. Rather than, like he talked about it, turn just to the next book of the Bible, Ephesians chapter 2. Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8. We'll just look at verses 8, 9, and 10. "For it is by grace that you're saved through faith, and it's not of yourselves, not from yourselves. It is the gift of God. You are not saved by the law. You're not saved by works, so that anyone could boast." Because if you were saved by works and God were to say to you, "Why should I let you into my heaven?" Because you'd say, "Hey, man, I was a great guy. I was a great guy. Everybody knows what a great guy I was." He'd say, "No, you're not going to pull that when you stand before God. You're not saved from your sin by your works. If God says be perfect in everything you do, and you're not perfect, and he does say that, you need to be holy like I'm holy. If you're not holy, you think he gives extra credit for good works?" No, he doesn't give any extra credit. He said, if you're not holy, if you blew it, and you blew it, and you blew it, it's over. You need to be saved by grace, only what I can do. Grace is being made righteous by God and God alone. Debbie read some scripture today from Psalm 62. I want you to turn to Psalm 62. Debbie, what was that? What did you read from today? New Living? New Living. I like that. I'm going to read from the New International Version, but Psalm 62. I remember I was telling the guys at our prayer time yesterday, we had our Zoom prayer time, and Psalm 62, verses 1 and 2. "My soul finds its rest in" what? "God alone. My salvation comes from him. He alone is my rock and my salvation. He is my fortress. I will never be shaken." Once again, verse 1, "My soul finds its rest in God alone. He alone, or excuse me, my salvation comes from him alone." So you're saved by good works? Nope. Don't have enough. You just can't do it. The works will not save you from your sin, nor will it save anybody else. I don't care how great your neighbors or your grandma is. No, not saved by works. Otherwise, we'd take all the credit for such a good person, and God would say, I already know you. You can't make up for what you've done. Other texts that speak that God alone is our salvation. Jonah chapter 2, verse 9. Won't look these up right now. Psalm 37, verse 39. And Acts chapter 4, verse 12. There is salvation in no other name. No other name but the name of Jesus. You need a Savior. Everyone needs a Savior. And there is one and only one Savior. And Paul says to these people that he knew many of them face to face. Why is it that you're slipping back? You've abandoned this grace in which we stood. In chapter 2, verses 15 and 16, turn to chapter 2 of Galatians, verses 15 and 16. And we'll see there what we are justified, made right, made righteous by faith. And again, by faith alone. Galatians chapter 2, verses 15 and 16. We who are Jews by birth and not sinners. Does that sound arrogant? Well, trust me, it's not arrogant. It's really not. Just stick with me. We who are Jews by birth and not Gentile sinners know that a man is not justified by observing the law, but by faith in Jesus Christ. So, we too have put our faith in Christ Jesus, that we may be justified by faith in Christ and not by observing the law. Because by observing the law, no one will be justified. Now, this is verse 16, he starts to just unwind that statement. We are Jews by birth and we're not Gentile sinners. He's not saying we're really good. He's saying we come in to heaven, we come into a relationship with God the very same way as anybody does. Everybody is under this standard. We're not saying we're better than the Gentiles because we know that a man is not justified or not made righteous, is not made clean, is not made holy by observing the law. We all realize, if you think you're cleaned up by the things you do, whether you're a Gentile or a Jew, you're barking up the wrong tree. We are saved, just like the Gentiles, by faith in Jesus Christ. So we too, just like you, only come in this way by putting our faith in Christ. Justified. We'll keep unpacking that word, justified, in the days ahead. Abraham believed God, and it was credited to him as what? It was righteousness. You believe me, God said to Abraham. And that's the way you need to continue to live your life. You just continue to believe me. And that's the righteousness that I'm talking about. And the songs that Dan picked out today, so many of them were really by faith songs. This is how we live our lives. We live it by faith. Chapter 3, verses 1 through 3. Now this is where he gets insulting, right? This is where he doesn't pull any punches. Chapter 3, verses 1 through 3. And again, this is in the New Living, and I'll just call your attention to another part of this as we get down to verse 3. You foolish Galatians! You ever written a letter like, wait a second, I think I've gotten a few of those letters from people who know me well, so that's kind of the tough part of it. You foolish Galatians! Who has bewitched you? Before your very eyes, Jesus Christ was clearly portrayed as crucified. I came, I shared the gospel with you, I gave the picture of Christ who was crucified, who hung there on that cross and stayed there on that cross out of love for you and out of a commitment to make you righteous as you would turn to him. So Christ was clearly portrayed before you as crucified, but also as resurrected and as living and as coming again. Before your very eyes, Jesus Christ was clearly portrayed as crucified. So I would like to learn this one thing from you. Did you receive the Spirit, that is the Holy Spirit, by observing the law or by believing what you heard? The answer to that one is nobody ever received the Holy Spirit by what they did. Oh, you've been doing so well today. Instead of a star, I'm going to give you the Holy Spirit. Didn't come that way. The day you put your trust in Christ, if you have actually put your trust in Christ as your only hope, your only salvation, when you put your trust in Christ that day, whether you felt it or not, you didn't feel a tingle. As some people have said, God didn't jump out of heaven and shake your hand. He implanted in you the Holy Spirit to live and change things. That's why when the Old Testament prophet, when Jeremiah wrote, speaking, God says, this is the message for you to give to my people, that there's going to come a day when the law will be written on your hearts. And when that happens, life will radically change. And it will change in this way. The Holy Spirit will be the one who will, this just helps me understand this, as if it were he cleared his throat and said, you really want to go there? Do you really want to continue in that path? I was thinking this week, a number of times, I'm sure that the Holy Spirit living in me was saying, don't go down that road. Don't. It might have been pride. Oh, it had to have been pride that prompted a critical spirit. How could anybody be that dumb? Yeah. Maybe it was somebody I was speaking to, or maybe it was somebody I was seeing on television. And the Spirit said, you really want to go there? So he convicts of sin, and he reminds us of what his standard is. Verse 3, are you so foolish? After beginning in the Spirit, are you now trying to attain your goal by human effort? I think that kind of minimizes that in the NIV. It minimizes this. It has more to do with, are you now becoming complete? Are you now being made perfect by the works of the flesh? I've listened to a couple of lectures from Hillsdale College recently, talking about Ben Franklin, one of our amazing founders of our country. And Ben Franklin was always learning, and he believed that the uniqueness of humanity was the fact that we had a brain and a mind, and we could improve ourselves, we could improve our situation, and that we could improve our situation, especially when it comes to issues like virtue. And those are high and noble thoughts. But Paul says, listen, this goes way beyond you improving yourself. Are you now made perfect by the works of the flesh? You just study and study and study the law. You take it, and the law is good, and Paul's going to talk about that. The law is good, but it has a purpose. It has a very distinct purpose, and we'll unpack that as we go through this week. Freedom. We've talked about being bewitched. Freedom. Chapter 5, verse 13. I was going to put in chapter 5, verse 1, so I'll talk about it right now. Chapter 5, verse 1. It is for freedom that Christ has set us free. Free from the law. Don't give up. He's not going to give up on the law for what it was good for. It is for freedom that Christ has set us free. So stand firm then, and do not let yourselves be burdened again by a yoke of slavery. Verse 13. You, my brothers, were called to be free. But do not use your freedom, I'm free to do everything, to indulge the sinful nature. Rather, serve one another in love. He's not talking, you brothers were called to be free, so but don't go down a path that says I'm free to do whatever I want. I can say anything I want. I know we have freedom of speech. So that means I can just tell anybody off. Well, let me tell you, those words don't necessarily come from a spirit-driven life. To insult people, to mock people, no. Don't use your freedom, to indulge, to steamroll somebody else so that you get what they deserve in terms of maybe wealth, or don't use your freedom to connive your way into or using somebody for your own selfish reasons, to do your own thing. Freedom, not to be bound by the stuff that drags us down. To have as much, I've thought often about this. If I just had all the wealth in the world, what would I do with it? I wouldn't have a clue. No, not that I wouldn't have a clue as to what I'd do. Oh, I've got way too many clues as to what I'd do. And how would I decide today? Should I fly to the Alps? You know, I could do it just like that, you know. Take my skis and I could have any kind of skis I wanted. And I could have somebody to carry my skis for me and cook my dinner for me and the best dinners. But, well, no, I don't know if I want to do that today. I could do it, but I'd really like to sail my yacht so I could fly to wherever one of my yachts was or one of my homes was. And I would just have the hardest time managing my calendar. I wouldn't, how do you even choose when you've got it all? I'd be bound by having too much stuff. In another way, I could be bound. And Jesus talks about being bound, you know, when I can do whatever I want to whomever I want. But he talks about sin. And he said to the Pharisees who said to him, are you talking about us being bound? We've never been bound. We're not slaves. And Jesus just laid it right on the line. He says, if you sin, you're a slave. You are a slave to sin. And it lays into you. Verse 16. So I say, live by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the sinful nature. I think as I was talking with somebody not all that long ago, we were talking about feeling carnal, and trying to get on top of our pride, and trying to get on top of the thoughts that are just not worthy of a man or woman, and indulging those thoughts in ways that our culture and our generation can so easily indulge in those things. And we talked about going in circles about, well, how do I get on top of that? What can I do to get ahead of that? And what can I do? What can I do to get ahead of it? And this was the verse 16 of chapter 5 is like one of those verses that is just central to the book of Ephesians. Paul says, live by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the sinful nature. Does that, like, how do you understand that, quote, formula? Is that a formula for success? It's just this amazing reality. If we are living by the Spirit, it means we're simply not indulging the flesh. And I recalled then what I heard many decades ago from an evangelist. And I, at that point in time, I think I was once again caught in the midst of trying to get control of my, whatever those desires were. And I was trying to stamp down those desires, stamp them down. Come on, just don't go there, don't go there, don't go there. And the evangelist said this, you know, Satan, I've just recommended to everybody today at the beginning of this message that we need to memorize these verses. Satan would be absolutely delighted if you would memorize this verse. Do you know that? He would really love you to memorize it, but he wants you to memorize it his way. His way is just kind of to turn the words around a little, just a little bit. Where the verse would read something like this. Don't fulfill the desires of the flesh, and then you'll be walking in the Spirit. Do you hear the difference? Get on top of your desires, and then the Spirit will feel like he's got free rein in your life. Say no to shooting your mouth off, and then the Spirit will say, okay, I'll hang out with you now. No. Say whatever, it could be sexual desires, it could be power desires. Don't say no, 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 no to those desires. The text is walk by the Spirit. Live by the Spirit. Walk by the Spirit. And you won't go there. Because the Spirit, you'll be lit. Walking by the Spirit is listening to the Spirit, listening to God's word, chewing on his word, listening when the Spirit says, in a, because he convicts the world of sin, no, don't go there. You don't need to go there. Rather than think about this person with some, I can hear you. I can hear you. You're thinking of that person as having selfish motives. Do you really want to go down that path? The Spirit is communicating. Really? Oh, that's right. Walk by the Spirit. And the Spirit would say, why don't you take Paul's words from that you've memorized from Colossians chapter 1, verse 9. Colossians chapter 1, verse 9. Ever since we heard about your faith in Christ, we've not stopped praying that you will grow in the knowledge of his will. Instead of deciding that this person is off base and you feel puffed up a little bit more by yourself, grow in your prayer life for those people. Walking in the Spirit, Jesus said. He said in John chapter 15, Jesus spoke to it of it as abiding in me. If you abide in me and my word abides in you, ask whatever you would and it'll be done for you. This is my Father's will, that you bear much fruit and so prove yourself to be my disciple. And how do you bear fruit? How do you produce the stuff that God fully intends for you to produce? It's just by walking in the Spirit, by abiding in Christ, just hanging out with him. Aware. I don't have to drum. I just have to remember. Just remember. And the Spirit will remind me, I'm here. I'm here. So yield yourself to the Spirit. Walk, that's walking in the Spirit. And that's freedom. And that's a lifestyle. This is the lifestyle. The title of this message and this series, Lifestyles, is coming from this verse for me. This lifestyle is walking in the Spirit. Chapter 6. Chapters 4, 5, and 6, especially 5 and 6, get so practical. But chapter 6, verse 14, Paul says at the end of this little letter, "May I never boast, in anything except the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, through which the world has been crucified to me and I to the world." Oh, I'd like to think I'm a great preacher. I'd like to think I'm a great father. I'd like to boast about those things. I'd like I'd love to be in the Hall of Fame for something. I can think of a lot of things I'm not going to be in the Hall of Fame for, but some Hall of Fame. Paul says, may I never boast except in the cross of Christ, because it's only what he can do for me to make me righteous. Now listen, it's only what he can do to make me righteous for eternity. And it's only what he can do for me as I live my life now that gives me the freedom to enjoy life. The freedom to enjoy the people around me, the freedom to invest my life in the lives of people around me, the freedom to easily just say, "No, you first," because it's only in the cross of Christ that I find that kind of freedom, a freedom and only what he could do for me. And so I've been crucified. I have crucified the world to me and I to the world. I hope you'll memorize these verses. I hope you'll think deeply about them. I hope you'll just enjoy. If you don't say I can't memorize, that's okay. I'm old too. I'm older than a lot of you. So don't go there. You don't have to go there. Just start chewing on these verses. Just chew on them and savor them along with the rest of this letter. And we'll just, we'll examine it a little bit more in depth, each one of these chapters. And may God cause us to grow. May he stir our hearts to grow in his grace. Father, thank you so much for your word. I thank you for those who introduced me to you and to your word, every single person along the way. Thank you for those who have studied the word and meditated in it. And I pray, Father, I know we live in a world where people are working real hard to make themselves better. I pray, Lord, that we would find that the only way we get better is by yielding our lives to you. And I pray you'd teach me more and more that truth and remind me. I thank you for the Holy Spirit who lives in me and lives in us. Bless us now and in the days ahead as we listen to you and walk in the Spirit. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.